From Pacifica, this is Democracy Now!
The parole board last night granted a 90-day stay for Troy Davis. This saves Troy Davis's life, at least temporarily, so they can review the case more closely. And hopefully they'll permanently commute a sentence to life or life without parole.
Less than 24 hours before he was scheduled to be killed by the state of Georgia, Troy Anthony Davis has been granted a 90-day stay of execution. We'll get the latest. Then we'll play what were long secret tape recordings of executions in Georgia.
Colonel Lowe?
Yes.
Mickey, the execution is now in progress. When it first surge entered his body, he stiffened and I heard a pop as if one of the straps broke, but I can't tell from this vantage point. He is still at this time sitting there with clenched fists with no other movement. He's slowly relaxing at this time.
Then, finally, we remain in Georgia with the shocking story of Janarla Wilson, a 17-year-old African-American sentenced to 10 years in prison for having consensual oral sex with a 15-year-old. He has already served 2 years when a court ordered his release.
This has been a really long 28 months. It's a very long fight. And right now, we have an order of release, and I beg the Attorney General of the state of Georgia, please enough, do not file an appeal, please.
The Attorney General did appeal. Janarla Wilson remains in jail. The case goes before the Georgia Supreme Court on Friday. We'll speak with Janarla Wilson's mother. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. Japan's largest nuclear power plant remains shut down for a second day following an earthquake that killed 9 people and left 13,000 homeless. The earthquake caused about 300 gallons of radioactive water to spill into the sea. Japanese officials are also investigating whether a second radioactive leak occurred at the plant. 100 barrels containing nuclear waste tipped over in the earthquake. Government officials said the 6.8 magnitude earthquake was bigger than the seismic level that the reactors were designed to withstand. But officials claim the leak did not pose a danger to the public. Jan Baranek of Greenpeace International said, quote, "This fire and radioactive leakage reminds us yet again of the serious threats posed by nuclear power." Here in Georgia, the execution of Troy Davis has been put off for at least 90 days. Davis was scheduled to be executed tonight at 7 p.m. Eastern Time, but the state's Board of Pardons and Paroles granted him a 90-day stay. In 1991, Davis was convicted of murdering a white police officer, but since then, many questions have been raised about the case. The murder weapon was never found. There's no DNA evidence or other physical evidence. 7 of the 9 non-police witnesses said they were coerced by police and have since recanted their testimony. In media news, Rupert Murdoch's News Corp has reached a tentative agreement to purchase Dow Jones & Company in the Wall Street Journal. On Monday, negotiators from News Corp and Dow Jones agreed to a $5 billion deal. But it must still be approved by the full Dow Jones board and the company's controlling shareholders, the Bancroft family. And news from Iraq. The U.S. military has acknowledged it's considering sending more troops to fight in the war. Marine General Peter Pace said that the Joint Chiefs of Staff are weighing a range of possible new directions in Iraq, including an even bigger troop buildup. The U.S. currently has about 160,000 troops in Iraq. Another 180,000 civilian contractors work in Iraq for the United States. On Capitol Hill, Senate Majority Leader Harry Reid has threatened to keep the Senate in session around the clock today in response to Republican efforts to block Iraq withdrawal legislation. Reid said, quote, "If Republicans don't allow a vote on Levin Reid today or tomorrow, we'll work straight through the night on Tuesday. The American people deserve an open and honest debate on this war, and they deserve an up or down vote on this amendment to end it," he said. The debate in the Senate comes as Prime Minister Nouri al-Maliki has backtracked from a statement he made over the weekend that Iraqi forces could handle the country's security anytime the U.S. military chooses to leave. Maliki told NBC News Monday, "Iraq's security forces have more work to do."
"I hope this year will be the end of the building of our forces so that we are prepared to take control of security. This needs the cooperation of everyone involved."
General Peter Pace recently said the number of Iraqi battalions who can operate wholly independently of the U.S. forces has fallen in the past year from 10 to only 6. Meanwhile, Iraq's former Prime Minister, Iyad Alawi, warned Monday the violence in Iraq may get even worse.
The current situation is very bad. The country is slipping into more chaos, more sectarianism, and divisions within the country. The bloodshed is becoming appalling and unacceptable. Frankly, I cannot see the political process continuing as is now, because the country is on the verge of a big disaster.
The Reuters news agency is calling for a thorough and objective investigation into the U.S. military action last week that left two of its Iraqi staff members dead. Reuters photographer Namir Nur Eldin and driver Saeed Chmagh were killed on Thursday in what witnesses said was a U.S. helicopter attack. The U.S. claims they were killed in a firefight. Reuters announced Monday it has recovered two cameras that were being used by Nur Eldin. Photos on the cameras show no evidence of the firefight described by the U.S. military. Reuters editor-in-chief David Schlesinger said, quote, "Our preliminary investigation raises real questions about whether there was fighting at the time the two men were killed." In the Iraqi port city of Basra, hundreds of oil industry workers demonstrated Monday to protest a draft oil law that would open up Iraq's oil reserves to foreign companies. Protest organizers accused the United States of trying to control Iraq's wealth. They issued a statement that read, quote, "If this is endorsed by the parliament, it would abolish sovereignty and hand over the wealth of this generation and the generations to come as a gift to the occupier." President Bush announced Monday the U.S. would give the Palestinian Authority $190 million in new aid, and he outlined plans for an international summit on the Israel-Palestine conflict.
So I will call together an international meeting this fall of representatives from nations that support a two-state solution, reject violence, recognize Israel's right to exist, and commit to all previous agreements between the parties. The key participants in this meeting will be the Israelis, the Palestinians, and their neighbors in the region.
President Bush appears set on excluding Hamas from the meeting, even though Hamas won the most recent election in the Palestinian territories. The president's speech came hours after Palestinian President Mahmoud Abbas met with Israeli Prime Minister Ehud Olmert. Hamas officials criticized the Abbas-Olmert meeting. This is Hamas leader Mahmoud al-Zahar.
This meeting is not the first, nor is it the last, and it aims to give the illusion that there is progress in the peace process. The U.S. and Israeli side have nothing to give the Palestinians. It is merely an attempt to sway Palestinian public opinion, which says there is no good in holding talks with these people. They will fool the Arab and Islamic world by releasing 250 Palestinian prisoners.
In news from Africa, Ethiopia's High Court has sentenced 35 opposition leaders, journalists, and human rights activists to life in prison for their involvement in protests following the disputed 2005 election. International human rights groups criticized the trial as an attempt to silence the critics of Prime Minister Meles Zenawi. In the Mexican city of Oaxaca, at least 50 people have been injured, 60 detained after police violently blocked a march led by local teachers and members of APO, the Popular Assembly of the Peoples of Oaxaca. There are reports that one protester died. The Mexican League for the Defense of Human Rights accused police of brutally beating the demonstrators and roughing up several journalists. New government statistics show the number of immigrants detained in the United States has nearly tripled since 2001. Last year, Immigration and Customs Enforcement detained 283,000 people, or about 775 a day. Meanwhile, in Wisconsin, members of the immigrant rights group Voces de la Frontera held a rally on Monday to protest Lou Dobbs' dominance of the immigration debate. Lou Dobbs hosts a nightly show on CNN and has been an outspoken critic of the immigrant rights movement. At the demonstration, protesters all wore masks of Lou Dobbs. In Gina, Louisiana, two men have been arrested after they ran over a church sign at a black church. Gina is the town where six black teenagers were charged with attempted murder for engaging in a schoolyard fight after the students found three nooses hanging from a tree at the school. Last week, the NAACP held a meeting at the Antioch Baptist Church to discuss the case of the Gina Six and the racial atmosphere in the town. Hours later, police say John Sanderson and Jerry Bufkin ran over a sign at the church. The men have been charged with criminal damage to property. The church's pastor called the actions a hate crime. And in Washington, Republican Senator David Vitter of Louisiana has announced he will not resign, even though he admitted making telephone calls to an alleged prostitution ring in Washington. Vitter said the incident was, quote, a very serious sin in my past for which I am, of course, completely responsible. Vitter is a first-term senator who also serves as Southern Regional Chair for Republican Rudolph Giuliani's presidential campaign. Vitter became a congressman in 1999, replacing Republican Bob Livingston, who resigned after an adultery scandal. At the time, Vitter praised Livingston's decision, and he called on President Bill Clinton to do the same because of the Monica Lewinsky scandal. Vitter said, quote, I think Livingston stepping down makes a very powerful argument that Clinton should resign as well and move beyond this mess. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. Less than 24 hours before he was scheduled to die by lethal injection, Troy Anthony Davis has been granted a 90-day stay of execution. The 38-year-old African-American from Savannah, Georgia, has been on death row for more than 15 years for a murder he says he did not commit. Davis was convicted in 91 for the killing of white police officer Mark Allen McPhail. With no physical evidence or murder weapon, the prosecution's case rested entirely on witness testimony. But seven of the nine non-police witnesses said they were coerced by police and have since recanted their testimony. Nine witnesses have implicated another man in the murder. Davis's execution appeared inevitable last month when the Supreme Court refused his final request for appeal. That left only the Georgia State Board of Pardons and Paroles. Last night, it agreed to review evidence from Davis's defense team and hear the new testimony of eyewitnesses. After the ruling, Troy Davis spoke to reporters by cell phone. He said, quote, I'm elated. I'm blessed and thankful. I'm one step closer to my freedom. Groups including Amnesty International have rallied behind Davis's case. Former FBI Director William Sessions submitted a written clemency appeal on Davis's behalf, while the Council of Europe urged the United States not to commit what it said would be an error it would come to regret. And Georgia Congressmember John Lewis testified in person before the parole board yesterday. Yesterday, I interviewed Troy Davis's sister, Martina Correa. She has led the fight for her brother's life. Today, we go back to Atlanta, where I'm joined by attorney Chris Adams. He's director of Georgia Capital Defender, a public office providing representation and support in death penalty cases. He's co-chair of the National Association of Criminal Defense Lawyers Death Penalty Committee. Welcome to Democracy Now!, Chris Adams.
Thank you very much.
Can you talk about what happened in this hearing yesterday? We talked with Troy Davis's sister just as she was walking into the federal building where it was taking place.
The way the Pardons and Parole Board in Georgia does the clemency hearings is they have two separate hearings. And the supporters of Troy Davis come and have one meeting, and then the supporters of the victim and the victim's family come for a second meeting. And these two meetings took more than 9 hours. And the defense presented testimony from five witnesses who were not heard from at the trial. And they deliberated well into the night before issuing the 90-day stay.
What exactly was it based on, and what does a 90-day stay mean?
A 90-day stay is fairly unusual here in Georgia. What their press release indicated is they're going to study the case and examine the case more and needed additional time to do that. And apparently they thought 90 days would be sufficient to do that. The defense, Troy Davis's lawyers, who, by the way, are all volunteer lawyers out of Washington, D.C., they brought forward five witnesses who weren't heard from at the trial, and they offered to bring forward the seven witnesses who have recanted. And apparently the parole board is inclined to hear that type of testimony, and I expect a second hearing will be scheduled.
Can you explain how the U.S. Supreme Court turned this down and yet the Georgia Board of Pardons and Paroles starts to reconsider the case.
Sure. There are people who are executed all over this country who have questions about the case, about the fairness of the trial, and about the process. And since the mid-90s, we've had the effective terrorism and anti-death, or effective ADEPA. It's a mouthful. At any rate, the federal courts now review state courts' findings with great restrictions placed on them. And the Supreme Court, as they do in most cases, just chose not to review this one. And they said there was no way for these issues to be properly in front of the federal courts for review.
So what happens? The parole board, in a sense, retries the case?
The parole board here would only be able to commute his sentence from a death sentence to either life without parole or life with parole. The lawyers also have a pending application in front of the Georgia Supreme Court for a motion for new trial based on after-discovered evidence, based on the five new witnesses who exonerate Troy Davis.
What has been the response in the local media, Chris Adams?
Let me share with you. This morning's Atlanta Journal-Constitution has an article out that I believe you should be able to see. And the media support around the state has been very supportive of the defense of Troy Davis and the claims of unfairness in his trial. The tone of the article is that they're somewhat relieved, and that most of the people involved in the proceeding are somewhat relieved that this 90-day stay was granted. And I believe people would be more relieved if he's permanently has his death sentence commuted.
Do you have any sense of how many people faxed the parole board up until yesterday?
I do not.
And does that kind of pressure make a difference, do you feel? And who serves on that board?
The board is appointed by the governor. There was a vacancy recently, and they appointed a career prosecutor, someone who'd spent 28 years as a head district attorney and had tried a number of death penalty cases, put a number of death penalty defendants on death row in Georgia. So the board is not generally viewed as being defense friendly. And so it's a real uphill battle by the time you get to the last minute and try to get your sentence commuted. But I applaud them for taking the time to review this case very carefully. And apparently this is a case that needs careful scrutiny.
Not only witnesses who have come forward, it's jurors. I believe at least two have said if they knew then what they knew now, they would not have convicted Troy Davis. Is that accurate, Chris Adams?
I believe that is accurate. And there were also faxes from William Sessions and
the former FBI director.
The former FBI director, in the presence of John Lewis, who is quite a hero to a number of people and a legend from the civil rights movement. He was there sitting on the front row in support of Troy Davis's application yesterday.
We're talking to Chris Adams, director of the Georgia Capitol Defender. So what happens after 90 days, after this 90-day stay?
If they do not commute the sentence, Troy Davis will be executed 3 months from today.
What are you planning to do in this time? What is the Georgia Capitol Defender going to do?
Well, we actually do not have any direct involvement in the case. We're a trial office and represent people now at trial. So our job would be, if another case like Troy Davis's came along, that we would try to work hard to make sure he gets acquitted and talk to all the witnesses the first time. I believe his lawyers will be working feverishly to shore up their claims and to prepare for an evidentiary hearing. And hopefully the Georgia Supreme Court will consider their petition for motion for new trial. So they'll be working on these dual tracks, both through the court system and at the parole board, trying to get as good a result as they possibly can for Mr. Davis.
After break, we're going to play some remarkable tapes from Georgia, something the state of Georgia never wanted people to hear. Secret tape recordings made of actual executions. Before we go to break, Chris, can you describe the significance of these? We're going to play one that's an actual execution and one that's a botched execution.
For years, the defense community had been told there were never any problems with electrocution in Georgia. And we were all stunned when these tapes were discovered. We never knew that those had been made. It's chilling. The tapes are chilling and led directly to the Supreme Court finding the use of electrocution in Georgia to be a violation of cruel and unusual punishment.
We're talking to Chris Adams, director of the Georgia Capitol Defender. Stay with us. We're going to break, and then you will hear some shocking audio tape. We want you to listen very carefully. Stay with us.
I'm returning it with arms. I may not make it back. This I'm sending to my moms. Faith is depleting cause my people are bleeding and my people are needing cause history is repeating and my eyes are seeing brothers hanging from an oak. Intravenous events, breaths are starting to get short. Well, my way is just a redeeming form of justice. So how come when I look upon these cells I see just us? Must trust in God like the dollar bill. The U.S. Mint keeps the eyes tint up Capitol Hill like Amityville. I'm gonna haunt that house. To this racially biased penalty is denounced and announced all the travesties to man. And up in my mail comes the deeds to our land. And the revolution is broadcasted in stereo. Plus the welfare poets playing resistance on the radio.
Most of us cannot afford to hire an attorney. I'm poor, so there's a higher chance that they gon' murder me. The murder rates are low in states without the penalty. Juveniles and mentally ill on the penalty. The penalty is racist. That's the penalty. We can't keep justifying murder as a remedy. We coming for you pronto, this land is nacho. We riding horses, wearing ponchos, y es por eso que yo canto. Pa' la mujer encarcelada y enterrada, 55 hay, 55 morirán en
huelga. Call for Hassan by the welfare poets. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The case of Anthony Troy Davis has renewed debate over issues of the death penalty and race in this country, but it's not the first time the controversy has come out of Georgia's prison system. In 2001, radio producer Dave Isay released the execution tapes, 19 recordings of the 23 electrocutions carried out by the state of Georgia since 1984. They remain the only recordings of executions in the United States that we know of. They were recorded internally by the Georgia Department of Corrections as a secret official record of the executions. Today, we'll hear two of the recordings. We begin with the execution of Ivan Ray Stanley, electrocuted July 12, 1984. Stanley was convicted of being an accomplice, but not the trigger man in the murder of an insurance salesman. The man convicted for the direct killing had his death sentence commuted to life in prison. Ivan Ray Stanley had an IQ of 62. What follows is a recording of a phone conversation between top corrections officials in Atlanta and the prison personnel in a room next to the death chamber. The main speaker is Willis Marable, an assistant to the warden at the Georgia Diagnostic and Classification Prison in Jackson, Georgia, where all the state's executions are carried out. Listen carefully.
This is a recording of the execution of Ivan Ray Stanley, EF-103-603, July the 12th, 1984.
Colonel Lowe, Mickey?
Yes.
The witnesses are now entering the witness room.
Okay.
The state witnesses have entered the witness room and have seated themselves on the front row. At this time, the news media witnesses are entering. All witnesses have arrived and have seated.
Let's proceed.
We can proceed if you're ready.
Colonel Lowe, Mickey, the warden has entered the execution chamber at this time, approaching the microphone, and is in the process of briefing all witnesses to remain quiet and to avoid any unnecessary movement. He is also advising them that medical assistance is available if needed. The warden at this time is in the process of confirming all witnesses. All witnesses have been confirmed. The warden is in the process of advising all witnesses that we will now proceed with the court-ordered execution of Ivan Stanley. Mickey, Colonel Lowe?
Yes.
We're still waiting for the execution team members to bring him into the execution chamber.
All right,
we'll
just stand by and keep a line up.
Colonel Lowe, Mickey? The execution team is now in the process of
killed and the condemned into the execution chamber. He is walking unassisted, walked straight to the chair and has seated himself in it. One of the execution team members is now in the process of securing the back strap. The other members are in the process of securing the arm straps and leg straps. The back strap is secure at this time. Both arm straps are secure at this time. They're still in the process of securing the leg straps. At this time, the condemned has been secured in the chair. He is not moving. He's just sitting there very passively staring out at the witnesses. The superintendent has afforded the condemned an opportunity to make a last statement. He has declined to make a last statement.
Are you ready to tell him that?
He has afforded the opportunity for prayer. He declined this also. The warden is now in the process of reading the essential court order to the witnesses and to the condemned.
The court has sentenced the defendant Alan Ray Samuel, 15th day of January, 1977.
The condemned is still sitting there very passively, no movement, staring out into the witnesses. The superintendent is still in the process of reading the court order to the condemned. This time, the superintendent has completed reading the central court order. The execution team members are now in the execution chamber with the headset and the leg band. One member is in the process of securing the leg band to the fleshy part of the inmate's right leg. Two members of the execution team is in the process of securing the headset to the condemned. The condemned has offered no resistance throughout. He's just sitting there very passively, not moving. The leg band has been secured to the condemned's right leg, and also the headset has been secured to his head. Perspiration is now being wiped from the forehead of the condemned, and he is secure and ready for execution, with the exception of the hood being placed over his head and the wires being attached to the leg band and to the headset. The electrician now has entered the execution chamber and is in the process of securing the wire to the headset.
And moving very well. It's a good time to do it right now. Marable?
Yes, sir.
Stand still. Mickey, put William Hill on.
Hello?
William? Okay, Attorney General's here.
Okay.
Hill, this is Mike.
Yeah.
Have you got any reason why the execution shouldn't be carried out?
No, I don't.
Thank you.
All right. Colonel Hill, Colonel Lowe?
Yes.
Mickey? The wires have been attached and secured to the headset and to the leg band. The perspiration has been wiped again from the condemned's forehead, and the hood is being placed on at this time. The face hood has been secured. All of the warden and all execution team members have departed the execution chamber. Stand by for the warden's last telephone check.
Ralph, this is Commissioner.
Yes, sir.
There are no stays. You can proceed to carry out the official order of the court.
Very well. On my count of three, press your buttons. One, three. Colonel Lowe?
Yes.
Mickey, the execution is now in progress. When it first surge entered his body, he stiffened, and I heard a pop as if one of the straps broke, but I can't tell from this vantage point. He is still at this time sitting there with clenched fists with no other movement. He's slowly relaxing at this time. The first phase of the execution is completed. We are now into the second phase. The second phase is completed at this time. We are now into the third and final stage. From my vantage point, it seems that the inmate has relaxed somewhat. His fists are still clenched, but there is no movement from the condemned. There's still no movement from the individual. He's still just sitting there. His third phase completed. We're still into the third phase. Third phase and the execution is completed. We're now into the 5 minutes elapsed time. It appeared when the execution was completed and the power was off, he relaxed somewhat more than he was. It was pretty visible that he relaxed even more than what it seemed before.
Any reaction from the witnesses?
They're sitting very still, just observing. No, I see one or two of the media writing notes, taking notes, but other than that, they're just sitting staring into the execution chamber. Colonel Lowe, Mickey,
yes.
We have now completed 2 minutes of the 5 minutes lapse time. There's still no, very little movement from any of the witnesses. No one even taking notes at this time. They're just sitting there staring into the execution chamber.
All about ready to go in?
Yes. Okay, we got a few more seconds. Colonel Lowe, Mickey, we have now completed 5 minutes lapse time. Stand by for the doctors are now preparing to enter the execution chambers to check for life signs. The first physician has completed his examination. The second is now in the process of making his check. The second doctor has now completed his examination. The third and final doctor is in the process of making his check. The examination is completed. Stand by for the superintendent's time of death and confirmation of death.
Approximately 12:24, July 12, 1984,
the superintendent has advised all witnesses that death did occur at 12:24, this date. He has instructed all witnesses to depart the witness room and to be transported back to the front of the institution. Curtains are drawn at this time. Colonel Lowe, Mickey?
Yes.
That completes it.
Marable, see if you can find what that snap pop that you were talking about a while ago.
I think it was just the electricity arc. I don't think any strap broke anything. He just jerked real hard and caused the electricity to arc.
Okay.
Now the electrician is now in the process of taking the wire from the headset. They have removed the hood, the face hood, and are in the process now of taking or removing the headset. The headset has been removed. The electrician is now in the process of removing the electrical wire from the leg band. The electrical wire has been removed from the condemned's right leg. He has been removed from the electric chair at this time and being placed on the stretcher. He is being removed from the execution chamber at this time, and the execution team members are taking him to the autopsy room. That's all I can see, Colonel Lowe.
Is the warden available?
Just a minute. Caleb?
You and your staff did an excellent job. We appreciate it very much.
Okay, that we had a little bit of a scare. I don't know if they related it to you or not, that the popping sound.
Yeah.
We were thinking that what happened, because he sat there for that 3 minutes, that the water and the sponge on his leg ran out.
Right.
Right there by his foot. And we're thinking that that's just it was a like a little bolt of lightning.
Did you see anything?
No, they said Colonel Hardison and other people in the witness room said they didn't see anything like that. Now, I still feel good about it, really.
It ran too smooth, Ralph, but don't screw it up next time.
Okay.
Mike Bowers wants to say something now.
Okay.
Ralph, I second what Dave said. Very smooth job.
Okay. We appreciate it. Just get us another one.
Marable?
Here he is. Yes, thanks, sir.
Colonel Lowe?
Marable?
Yes, sir.
I want to thank you.
You're quite welcome, sir. Anytime.
Good night.
Good night, sir.
A tape recording of the execution of Yvonne Ray Stanley, killed by electrocution July 12, 1984. His IQ, 62. Next, we're going to play the recording of a botched execution. But first, we turn back now to our guest in Atlanta, Chris Adams, director of the Georgia Capitol Defender, a public office providing representation and support in death penalty cases. As you listen to this, Chris, These tapes secret for a long time, made by the state of Georgia, furious that these tapes were let out to the public. Acquired by a lawyer who worked on death penalty cases named Michael Mears, David Isay, the well-known public radio producer, got the execution tapes and had them played. Well, NPR nationally wouldn't play them, but together with WNYC, they released the tapes, and on Democracy Now! We also spent an hour. This was in 2001. But, Chris, the significance of this tape when it came to electrocution in Georgia.
What happened is the court had been struggling with, Georgia was one of the last states that used electrocution as a method of execution. And these tapes, when they came out, that pretty much did away. And our state Supreme Court declared that this was cruel and unusual punishment. And the state of Georgia then shifted to lethal injection, which has worked equally as barbarically as execution, as electrocution did.
Who determined that lethal injection is less barbaric than electrocution?
I think there was a national movement to try to eliminate people from our society at the hands of the government in a more humane way. And lethal injection became the law in many states, including Texas and other places. And Georgia shifted around 2000 and 2001 to lethal injection.
Chris Adams of Georgia Capitol Defender, we're now going to go to the second tape. We turn to the tape recording from the execution tapes. Alpha Otis O'Daniel Stevens was killed by electrocution on December 12, 1984. His was a so-called botched execution because it took more than one attempt to take his life. Stevens remained alive after the initial two-minute jolt to his body. He was electrocuted again after doctors pronounced him still alive following a six-minute pause. The total execution took more than 20 minutes. This recording was made from inside the death chamber. Again, listen carefully.
Carry out the execution by the order of the court. There's no reason to delay.
Very well. On my count of three, press the button. One, two, three.
The execution now has begun. There was one small jerk from the condemned at the time the execution was initiated. He is sitting very still now, and we are also now into the second phase of the execution. We are now into the third phase of the execution. No movement from the condemned. No activity and no movement from the witnesses. He appears to be relaxing a little bit more now. There's 60 seconds remaining on the third phase of the execution. There's a slight movement from the condemned's head. He seems to be moving his head from side to side slightly.
I show the time is 12:19.
Commissioner, he is still moving his head, and he seems to have slumped down in a relaxing type of position in the chair. But his head is moving from side to side slightly. Commissioner, Mr. Long, the execution is completed at this time. The electrical panel box is secured and locked. I do not detect any movement from the condemned at this time. He seems to have stopped moving his head and also his arms.
I show the time is 12:20.
You are in the lapse time countdown, is that correct?
Yes, sir. We're into the first minute of the lapse time now. No movement from any of the witnesses, and at this time, no movement from the condemned. We have now completed 1 minute of lapse time, 4 minutes remaining. 2 minutes of lapse time completed at this time, 3 minutes remaining. Still, very little movement from any of the witnesses, and I detect no movement from the condemned at this time.
I show the time is 12:22.
Commissioner?
Yes.
Mr. Long?
Yes, sir.
There is some slight movement. He's still moving his head slightly. The only thing we can do is continue until the physicians can check him after the lapse time has expired.
Don't vary from your checklist.
Okay, sir.
Okay, we have completed 3 minutes of lap time, 2 minutes remaining. Commissioner, Mr. Long?
Yes.
He is still moving his head slightly. Kind of a bobbing up and down movement. Commissioner?
Yes.
Mr. Long, we have completed 4 minutes of lapse time. We have 1 minute remaining. And from my vantage point, I do detect, or it seems to be, that he is breathing. Commissioner, Mr. Long, we have completed the 5 minutes lapse time. Stand by for the physician's check. Commissioner?
Yes.
It appears, and the doctors agree with me, that he's still breathing. You want us to check him and then go through it again, or just go ahead and go through it again?
Check him and then go through him again. Okay. Definitely check him. Don't vary from the checklist.
All right.
Have them check him.
Okay.
Breathe.
I can't think. Do we announce that we're going to do it again?
It doesn't say so.
Okay.
It remains on.
Okay.
Time at 12:26:30. Commissioner?
Yes.
Doctors verify that he is still alive.
Repeat the execution.
Very well.
Ready to go again? Ready.
Better check all the connections. Val?
Yes, sir.
Did you tell the witnesses that you were repeating?
No, I didn't.
I think you should tell him.
Okay. Do you want me to just advise him that...
Just advise him.
...the process and not go into any detail?
That's right.
Okay. Physicians have vital signs.
Wait a minute.
Tell the physicians have vital signs.
Commissioner,
vital.
The superintendent is entering the execution chamber and approaching the mic at this time to advise the witnesses that we will proceed again with the execution.
Willis, if you can, tell him there were some vital signs remaining, so the execution will repeat. You can get that message to him.
It's too late now. He's already briefed him, and he's on the way back in, sir.
All right.
I show the time is 12:28.
Okay, Commissioner, we'll proceed at this time.
Proceed.
On my count of three, the pressure button. One, two, three.
Commissioner, Mr. Long, the execution is initiated again at this time. The condemned made one big jerk, and now he is relaxing in the chair. I do not detect any other movement from the condemned at this time. We have completed the first and second phase of the execution. We are now into the third phase. I do detect his head moving from side to side again. Into the third phase of the execution. Commissioner? Mr. Long?
Yes.
He is still at this time moving his head from side to side and appears to be breathing. We'll continue just like we did previously.
You're going to have to check that leg.
We have 15 seconds remaining on the third phase of the execution. Commissioner, Mr. Long, the third phase of the execution is completed. The equipment is switched off, secured at this time. We're now into the 5 minutes lapse time.
What is the status on condemned?
Sir, he appears to be breathing to me.
You're going to have them check those sponges and check their connections. There's something they don't have connected right, Willis, for that.
Yes, sir. You want us to go ahead and complete this whole thing and then,
Yeah, complete your phase, and then you're going to have to make your check.
Okay, sir. Commissioner, Mr. Long, we have completed 1 minute of lapse time. We have 4 minutes remaining. I might also advise at this time that I do not detect any movement from him at this time. He appears to have stopped moving. Still no movement from any of the witnesses. They were just sitting very still, observing the condemned in the chair.
Show the time at 12:32.
We have now completed 2 minutes of phase time, lap time. We have 3 minutes remaining. Might also add that I do not detect any movement from the condemned. Commissioner, Mr. Long, we have now completed 3 minutes
lapse time. We have 2 minutes remaining. There is still no movement from the condemned. Commissioner, Mr. Long, we have completed 4 minutes of lapse time. We have 1 minute remaining. Still no one detectable movement from the condemned. He does seem to have stopped moving entirely. Commissioner, Mr. Long, we have completed our 5 minutes lapse time. Stand by for the physician's check. At this time, the superintendent and the two physicians are entering the execution chambers for their check. The first doctor is now in the process of making his check for vital signs.
Show the time at 12:36. The time is 12:37.
The second doctor is still in the process of conducting his check for vital signs.
12:37.
The superintendent is at this time, Commissioner, Mr. Long, is in the process of briefing the witnesses that at 12:37 hours, this date, the condemned was pronounced dead. He has instructed all witnesses to depart the witness room, back to the front of the institution. At this time, the curtains are drawn.
That was a recording from the execution of Alpha Otis O'Daniel Stevens. The execution actually lasted more than 20 minutes. To hear the full recordings from the execution tapes, you can go to public radio producer Dave Isay's website at soundportraits.org. And if you'd like to get a copy of today's broadcast, the DVD that has the transcription of these audio tapes that were secret for so long, recorded by the state of Georgia, you can get the DVD by going to our website at democracynow.org. When we come back, we'll be joined by Gennaro Wilson's mother. Gennaro Wilson was 17. He was convicted and sentenced to 10 years in prison for having consensual oral sex with a 15-year-old. He's been in jail now for more than 2 years. Stay with us.
I didn't even make the papers, 'cause I only kill one man. But my trial was over quickly.
Austin by Steve Earle here on Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. As we turn to another Georgia prison case that's attracting national attention, Gennaro Wilson, now 21 years old, African American, he's serving a 10-year prison sentence for having consensual oral sex when he was a teenager. He was 17 years old at the time. The girl was 15 years old when the sexual encounter took place. Wilson was convicted of felony aggravated child molestation. He's already spent more than 2 years behind bars. In a ruling last month, the Georgia judge criticized prosecutors and ordered Gennaro Wilson's release. But the state attorney general, Thurbert Baker, appealed the decision, saying the judge overstepped his bounds. On Friday, the case goes before Georgia's Supreme Court. Prosecutors have been accused of an overzealous campaign to keep Gennaro Wilson behind bars While the appeal took many by surprise, no one could have expected the bizarre action from the district attorney last week. David McDade publicly released some 35 copies of video allegedly showing the teen's sexual encounter. Georgia's chief federal prosecutor, David Namias, said the video constitutes child pornography and called on McDade to stop releasing copies. Namias did not rule out bringing criminal charges against McDade himself. In addition to releasing the tapes, McDade did not obscure the faces of the females to obscure their identity and did not try to keep the material under seal. Meanwhile, Georgia residents have launched a growing campaign to secure Gennaro Wilson's release. On Saturday, at least 2,000 people marched in Douglas County to protest his imprisonment. The group marched to the county courthouse chanting "Free Gennaro Wilson," singing civil rights songs. Supporters, including former President Jimmy Carter, the Reverend Joseph Lowry, and Senator Barack Obama, have also spoken out for Gennaro Wilson's release. Today, I am joined now from Atlanta by Gennaro Wilson's mother, Juanessa Bennett. She has led the campaign for her son's release. We welcome you to Democracy Now!
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Can you tell us what happened? How it was that your son, at the age of 17, who engaged in consensual oral sex with a 15-year-old. The 15-year-old's mother reiterated in the last few weeks that her daughter had engaged in consensual sexual encounter. How he ended up in jail?
She admitted from the beginning that it was consensual. I don't know really how the prosecutors came to the conclusion that there should be charges. According to a law that was in effect back then, the girl was not old enough to consent to any form of sexual behavior. The law has then been changed where it would be a misdemeanor, not more than 12 months prison, jail time for this type of action. But it was a law that was in effect at the time. When I came forward, I thought the prosecutor would use his discretion to try not to make this into as big as it has become. We never imagined it would be this big, but just like I said, the law was changed in 06, and it is now a misdemeanor, and that's the reason why we're still fighting, because we just can't understand how you can land 10 years prison time for something which is, you know, quite as simple as this.
Barack Obama, the Illinois senator, presidential candidate, said at the NAACP forum, "We know we have more work to do when Scooter Libby gets no prison time and a 21-year-old honor student who hadn't even committed a felony gets 10 years in prison." Tell us about your son, Gennaro. He's now been behind bars for, what, close to 2.5 years. Tell us about him.
He's been in now for 29 months exactly in prison. And in the prison system, and he definitely doesn't deserve it. He's quite matured a whole lot since then. His, you know, outlook on life is definitely different than, you know, the teenager that first went in. He has high hopes and high goals now. I'm not even quite sure if athletic ability is, you know, at the far, you know, it's not quite as important to him as it is now to try to help other youths to overcome some of the tragedies that they are going through, because it's so many other people who are out there who's, even at the rally on Saturday, it was several people who walked up to me, and I'm not quite sure what I can do, but was just begging for help, you know, in certain situations that they felt like they shouldn't have been in.
He was an honor student?
He was a B-plus student. He had a 3.2 grade average. He was first ever homecoming king for Douglas County. He was prom prince. He was all-conference in football and track for more than 2 years. He had received several letters that for certain colleges, mostly Ivy League schools, that were interested in him coming to go to school with them in the fall.
Does he have any chance of going to college now?
I think he does. I think there's always a chance. You know, once he gets out, I think there's always a chance that he can go. Not with a felony conviction, no, he wouldn't be able to obtain the education that he, you know, deserves to have. But I think it's a good chance that he'll be able to go back in. He's way behind. You know, he'll have to do a lot of catching up, maybe a whole lot of summer school. But I think he still has a chance. And now his major has, mostly he was in focus towards the medical field before. Now it's sociology, you know, in fields like that, or political economics or something.
His lawyer pleaded at the news conference that was held when the judge ordered his release for the Georgia Attorney General not to appeal the case. The Attorney General did, so it's going to be in Georgia Supreme Court on Friday. What do you expect from this?
I think the Supreme Court at this point will be fair, just as fair as the habeas judge, Judge Wilson. I was really shocked at Thurber Baker's request for an appeal. Way shocked. I didn't take it very well at all, because he has children and he know what children engage in. And I was just more shocked at the moral standards for this to come through, because as it was said before, Dave McDade passed out tapes to try to keep Gennaro incriminated. I really don't even understand it seems like it's a personal vendetta as far as him trying to keep him locked up. Several people have came publicly and said no one was hurt behind it. And now that the young lady's family is speaking out saying how, you know, they never wanted this to happen, I really couldn't understand Thurber Baker's reasoning behind making filing an appeal. But it's just led to other reactions, and so many people coming forward now who is questioning their abilities. You know, we've never said that we condone this type of behavior. My son was definitely, you know, made bad judgments of character. He definitely was not in his right state of mind. I don't condone the drinking or the hanging at that aspect, but it was definitely nothing that deserved 10 years, maybe some kind of rehabilitation or something to teach a lesson, but nothing extreme like this.
Juanessa Bennett, we only have a few seconds left, but how has this affected you, Gennaro's mother?
It's been very, very rough. Constant headaches, constant worration. Sometimes, you know, I don't know when I'm coming or going. My reactions have been mixed. It's been up and down, up and down, a whole lot of disappointments. But basically, I try to keep my head up and try to keep him going, to let him know that, you know, it will be a better day.
Does he believe he'll be out of prison soon?
He always keep faith. I always try to keep him encouraged that, you know, some kind of way the system will prevail, and that the unjust will become just.
Juanessa Bennett, I want to thank you very much for being with us, joining us from Atlanta, and we will certainly follow this case, Gennaro Wilson's mother. And that does it for today's broadcast. If you like a copy of the show, you can go to our website at democracynow.org. Democracy Now! Produced by Mike Burke, Shufa Dukaduz, John Hamilton, Elizabeth Press, Aaron Mate, Angelique Comet, Jeffrey Hagerman, Steve Martinez, Nicole Salazar, Carrie Mache, Kizzy Cox, John Gerberg, and Andalusia Knoll. Mike DeFilippo, Miguel Nogueira, our engineer. Special thanks to Elizabeth Press. I'm Amy Goodman. Thanks so much for joining us.